so rough. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to our service of worship this morning. We're so glad that you are here. I know a few more folks are going to be coming in, so just make room for them as they do come in. Whether you're joining us online or in person, thank you so much. If you're a guest with us today, we consider you an honored guest. Thank you so much for gracing us with your presence. And if you have not yet already been made to feel welcome, just give us a few minutes, and we'll be sure to take care of that during our greeting time. While I'm sharing with you the announcements, if you would, you'll find red pew pads on the end of each row. Would you please take those, fill them out, pass them down to your neighbor? And while you're doing that, I'm going to share with you some announcements so you know what's going on in the life of our church. Carrie is out this Sunday, and we are graced with the presence of Charles, is it Prater? Did I say that right? Okay, Charles Prater, friend of Robert and Emily's, and I know you're going to be blessed by his sharing of his gifts with us today. So please be aware of that. Next Sunday is our Brookdale Community Ministry. This is when we go up to the Brookdale Nursing Home in Tyler. And it's an extension of our communion table. So we take communion to them up there. And different folks involved, whether by giving a devotional or helping lead singing. If you'd like to help out with that, be sure to talk to Gloria Jones. Also, this Tuesday at 2 is our last Bible study, lectionary Bible study for the summer. We're going to take a little hiatus for July, and we'll be back in August after the school gets kicked off again. We'll start back up for the fall for our lectionary Bible studies. We'll continue to give you the scriptures each week in the bulletin, so you have the scriptures for next week, so you can be reading, studying them between now and next Sunday as well. There's some adjustments to the church offices hours coming up just for July 4th, and to be aware of that. Our mission barrel for July are blue jeans. We are collecting blue jeans for the mission house. If you have slightly used or gently used or new jeans or are being received, we've got yellow containers outside here, and you're welcome to drop those off all the way through the month of July. Now, We call them Blue Jean Sundays because not only are we collecting blue jeans, but you're invited to wear your blue jeans to church during the month of July. So I saw some thumbs up there. Hey, there we go. Okay. So if you'd like to do that, you're welcome to do that during the month of July. Save the date. Splash Kingdom, once again, coming up Sunday, August the 14th. This is when we rent out the entire water park of Splash Kingdom, which is up in Canton. And we invite all of our friends, neighbors, grandkids, in-laws, outlaws, anybody you want to invite, bring them along. We have the entire park to ourselves for 2 hours. This is in the evening, so it's after their regular hours. And it's a lot of fun. And even if you don't have kids and you just want to come float the lazy river for 2 hours, come on and join us. But be sure to let folks know about that. This is something we do for the community. We invite the community to come join us, and we have a lot of folks that come that have not had any connections to our church so that we can build relationships with them. This is one of our outreach events where we build relationships with our community, with our neighborhood, and invite them to build relationships. So hopefully maybe that becomes fruitful in ministry, and we have seen it through different ministries that we've done this way where people become a part of the church through these sort of things. So that is on Sunday, August the 14th. I do want to tell you about this last week. The UM Army team had a great week in Henderson. They had a successful week of mission work. They worked on 9 different sites that the whole crew of them. There was probably about 50 folks there. There are folks from Cyprus, from Pollard, from Troop, from where else am I forgetting, Katie? What's that? White House was there as well, and so Katie had our team with Bruce was there as well, and let's see, they had 2 sites where they did painting. They built 5 wheelchair ramps the entire week. One of them was 60 feet long to accommodate the family. They worked on porch railings and steps. In fact, they built 2 porches all together. So that's a lot of work for 1 week to get accomplished. Let's praise God for that, and that they're back safe. So we are really glad about that. All right. Is there anything I missed? Any announcements coming up that we need to say? If not, then let us stand and greet one another in the name of the Lord.
Longeth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee.
Please remain standing for our call to worship.
God is a God who calls. God is a God who equips. God is a God who sends. God is a God who blesses. Let us worship God. You may be seated as we prepare our hearts for worship.
Will you stand with me, please, as we sing For the Healing of the Nations?
For the healing of the nations, Lord, we pray with one accord. For a just and equal sharing of the things that earth affords, to a life of love and action, help us rise and pledge our word. Help us rise and pledge our word. Lead us forward into freedom from despair, your world release, that redeemed from war and hatred, all may come and go in peace. Show us how through care and goodness fear will die and hope increase. Fear will die and hope increase. Creator God, have written your great name on humankind. Growing in your likeness, bring the life of Christ to mind. That response and service, earth its destiny may find. Earth its destiny may find.
You may be seated for children's time.
All right, here we go. Would you put those up there for me? Thank you so much. All right, so we've got the box today. This young gentleman right here. For those of you that are new, let me see the box. Is it heavy? Got a little weight to it. Okay, so for those of you who do not know about the box, and we do have some guests with us today, the box we're doing during the month of June and July, and each week a kid will bring the box back with something in it, and I'll do a children's sermon based on whatever is in the box. Now, I do not know what's in the box, correct? You haven't shown me in advance or anything? Okay. Now, hold on. Don't be giving nothing away yet. Told me when she came in, I have a hard time keeping secrets. Don't keep it a secret just for a little bit longer, okay? So the three rules for the box are nothing living, nothing formally living, and must be appropriate for church, okay? So I'm going to do a children's time. Deirdre's not here to help me, so if I hem and haw a little bit, nobody start yelling out, he's stalling, because that may be what I'm doing. All right, are you ready? Ooh, I like what you said just a second ago when you said I get to keep these. Do I really? Let me show you what's in the box. Some very delicious looking cookies right here. Oh, they're chocolate chip? Those are my favorites. You knew that? Okay. Well, golly gee, who made these cookies? Mom made these cookies. Oh, thank you, Mom, for making cookies for us today. That's just absolutely wonderful. You know what? When you made these cookies, Mom, did you just get out a bowl and pull out the box that said cookies and go, poof? No, okay. So when you make cookies, it's not just something that's in a box that you go, poof, and make cookies, right? Now, there's some cookies you can get that you can slice those things out, but these look like the kind of cookies that were made with love, right, Mom? Okay, so when you make cookies with love like this, you put in all the right ingredients. Y'all know what ingredients are? What are the ingredients you put into a cookie? Do y'all know? Chocolate chips are good things to have in a cookie, okay? What else are good to have in chocolate chip cookies?
Dough.
You got to make the dough. But what is combined to make the dough? Milk, maybe flour. What else? Baking soda, was that? Okay, a little bit of that. Sugar. You know, you got to have sugar in cookies. I mean, come on. I mean, they're cookies and all that kind of stuff. So all of these things mixed together in a bowl, right? And did you use a blender? When y'all ever seen Mom use blenders and things like that, you know, all that mixes it all up, and then she makes them into little balls, and she puts them in the oven, and they all just melt down to this wonderful, beautiful thing we call a cookie. And a cookie is made up of many good and wonderful things. Do you know that God makes you guys up of some great and wonderful things? You know, when we become Christians and we trust Jesus as our Lord and Savior, He puts into our lives certain ingredients to make a Christian. He puts in there love. He puts a little love in there. And he puts a little joy in there, a little peace in there, a little self-control in there, a little faith in there, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, and self-control. Do you know what those things, those ingredients are called? The fruit of the Spirit. He does that, and He mixes those into our lives, and sometimes we're better at some than we are at others, but as we grow as Christians, those ingredients really mix in to make a flavorful life. And our life ought to be delicious in that way, you know? Loving and kind and gentle and peaceful. And just like a chocolate chip cookie, when we're around other people and they see those things inside of us, they must say, that's a good kiddo right there. That's a Christian, you know? So, can you remember that? To keep the good ingredients that God puts in your life in there so that others may see and say, wow, Jesus is doing something good in that person's life. Can y'all do that? Okay. All right. So now it's time for the box to be given to the next person. Now we're still going around for who has not had the box. Okay. Who put this? Was this your box? Okay. So she's not had the box yet. And you've not had the box yet, and you've not had the box yet, have you? Oh, you had it. Okay, so we got two of you. Now, are you going to be here next week? She may be, or she can be. Okay, all right. So it's between the two of you. Then we're going to do a count off, or we're going to pick a number between 1 and 5. Okay. Oh, wait. Oh, y'all won't be there. Decisions have been made right there. Another day, another Sunday, we can do it. So here you go, sweetheart. You get the box. She said that your mom and dad said that y'all are going to take care of that, right? Okay. All right. So let's have our prayer, all right? Dear Lord, thank you for cookies. And thank you for mixing in our heart good things like love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, and self-control. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, y'all are dismissed. I'll wait.
If you would, please stand for our affirmation of faith. We believe in one
mighty maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being, the Father. Through Him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate
of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life to come. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, as we gather together in your name this day, we give you all glory and praise and honor. And Lord, we live in a world where there's a lot of things going on, and a lot of things that hold our attention and capture our emotions. But Father, when we gather together on Sundays, we gather together for you. You are the audience to whom we sing our praises. This is not a presentation. This is not a theatrical thing. We are not an audience. We are a congregation. And as such, when we gather and we sit in these pews, we do so for your glory, as we sing your songs, as we pray your prayers, as we lift up your word. So we pray, Father, that today you may be glorified with our voices, with our hearts, with our minds, that we today would lay aside our burdens and concerns, our anxieties and our fears, and entrust them to you once again. We come, Lord, acknowledging our humanness, our need for forgiveness, and seek you for that very forgiveness. And Father, we also acknowledge that we can't live this life that you've called us to apart from your strength and power. And we do try that, oh Lord. Please forgive us and help us to step back onto the right path for you and for your name's sake. We are always a grateful people. We live our lives in gratitude. And we are especially grateful for Jesus, who taught us to pray, praying, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen."
Will you stand with me, please, as we sing, "Lord, I Want to Be a Christian"?
Lord, I want to be a Christian, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian, in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving, in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving, in my heart. Lord, I want to be like Jesus, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be like Jesus, in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want
take Jesus in my heart. Please remain standing.
Let us pray. Loving and welcoming God, we have time in our lives when for many months we sheltered in our homes, working from home, learning from home, worshiping from home. As we bring our tithes and offering to you this morning, you open our minds to a wider definition of home and a brighter definition of family. May the gifts we give today find their way to home projects, ways this world can feel like a safer, more loving home to all your children. In Christ's holy name we pray, amen. You may be seated.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated.
Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus.
now your burdens lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. Remember where sometimes you'll fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours like rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. With your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, then go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live.
At this time, I'd like to introduce today's Psalter response.
Remember the wonderful works of the Lord. Praise God, give thanks and sing.
At this time, I'd like to invite you to join with us in today's Psalter response.
Remember the wonderful works of the Lord. Praise God, give thanks and sing.
I cry aloud to God, aloud that God may hear me.
In my trouble, I seek the Lord.
In the night, my hand is stretched out continually. My soul refuses to be comforted. I will call to mind the deeds of the Lord. I will remember your wonders of old.
I will meditate on all your works and muse on your mighty deeds.
Your way, O God, is holy.
What God is great like our God?
You are the God who works wonders. You manifested your might among the peoples.
You redeemed with your arm your people, the descendants of Jacob and Joseph.
Remember the wonderful works of the Lord. Praise God, give thanks and sing.
When the waters saw you, O God, when the waters saw you, they were afraid and the very deeps trembled.
The clouds poured out water.
The skies gave forth thunder. Your arrows flashed on every side. The crash of your thunder was in the whirlwind. Your lightning illumined the world.
The earth trembled and shook.
Your way was through the sea, your path through the great waters, yet your footprints were unseen.
You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron.
Remember the wonderful works of the Lord. Praise God, give thanks and sing.
Today's scripture comes from Luke chapter 9, verses 51 through 62. As the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. And he sent messengers on ahead who went into a Samaritan village to get things ready for him. But the people there did not welcome him because he was heading for Jerusalem. When the disciples James and John saw this, they asked, "Lord, do you want us to call fire down from heaven to destroy them?" But Jesus turned and rebuked them. Then he and his disciples went to another village. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus replied, "Foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He said to another man, "Follow me." But he replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family." Jesus replied, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Would you pray with me? Gracious Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight this day, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen? Amen. Well, Reagan, our oldest, and her new husband, Cade, got back from their two-week honeymoon this weekend. And we were very glad to have them back in the States. They had flown around. They went to Rome. And they went to Venice, and then they went over to an island off of Spain, or Menorca or something like that, and they had a great time. I said, "Folks, this is the trip of a lifetime that you just went on," and they had a wonderful time. They had a great time. They came back. We got to see them yesterday. They came back, and they brought us gifts from the different places, and they knew that I liked mints, and and so they were in Rome, and they found this what they thought was a little metal container of mints with the Pope Francis's face on it. It said Papa Francis on it. They thought they were being kind of funny, you know. "Oh, look at Dad, this thing of mints from Rome and the Vatican." And so I start to open it up, and I kind of shake it a little bit, and I realize these aren't mints. And I open it up, and inside, of course, is the brightest pink rosary I've ever seen in my entire life. And they were just shocked, and I said, it's okay. It's the thought that counts, you know, and I still have my Altoids in my car, so we're okay. We're okay. We were over at the house not only to see them, but also to help kind of get things finalized in their apartment where they're living up in Tyler. And we were some things they wanted me to put on the wall, and there were they had a room with gifts all in it, so they, you know, Reagan and Rebecca went through and they marked who gave what, so they make sure they get out thank you notes and all that kind of good stuff. But we were there to help them get their first home all set up and ready for them. You know, home is a very powerful thing. The concept of home, the image of home is a very powerful image, and it's one that we see in Scripture time and time again. You know, when a college kid goes off to college, they look forward to coming home and seeing the folks. When a person is in the hospital, they long for home so they can sleep in their own bed and eat a decent meal. At the end of a long and exhausting vacation, when you've been on the road all day long, you look forward to coming home and sitting in your easy chair and putting your feet up. Home is a powerful thing. We all have within us this longing for home, this desire to be at that place that we call home. And I would add that this longing for home that lives inside of us actually goes deeper than just a desire or a drive for our earthly home. I believe there is a drive and a desire inside of us, a longing that God places in our hearts for an eternal home with Him. In this morning's scripture, Jesus is preparing to go home. I'd like to tell you that we're going to unpack this entire passage, but really, this morning, all I'm going to focus on is that very first verse in verse 51. Jesus is longing to go home, but he knows he has some things he has to take care of first. It says, as the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, or as the time had been approaching for him to go home, you might say, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. Now, as I mentioned, there were some things that he needed to do. The disciples obviously needed a little more instruction. They were wanting to send down fire and all kinds of bad things on this town that had rejected them, basically. And Jesus, no, there's more about I need to teach you, obviously. But it was this longing, though, that Jesus had. He was ready to go home. He was ready to go home, and he knew that time was coming when he would suffer, when he would die, when he would be raised again, and when he would ascend into heaven. He would go home, if you will. In John's Gospel, the 14th chapter, we read a very interesting story where Jesus is preparing the disciples for his going home. They are anxious because he has told them about his impending death. He has already told them about his impending suffering. And he has already told them that he will have to leave them. And they're very anxious about this fact. And so he seeks to comfort them by telling them about the home which he will go and prepare for them. He says, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms, and if it were not so, would I have not told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? He's telling them, I'm going to prepare a home for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Of course, follows up this up with Thomas saying, no, we don't know the way you're going. What are you talking about? And Jesus says, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No one comes home or no one comes to the Father except through me. The interesting thing about this interaction that Jesus has are the phrases and the words that he chooses when he talks to the disciples about going home. Because you see, in the first century world, when a young first century man has a fancy for a young first century girl, and he is ready to propose to her, he's ready to get down on one knee, what he does is what Jesus just did with the disciples. You see, in the first century, a young man takes his wife home with him to his father's home. That was the way things were. And so if he was going to do that, he had some preparatory work to do. And so he would go to the woman, and as way of asking her hand in marriage, he would say, listen, I would like to go and prepare a home for us. I would like to go home to my father's house, and I would like to get a room together for us. Maybe they would have to build that as an add-on to the home But I will. I am going to prepare a place for us, a room for us, a home for us, so that we have a place to call home. And as he goes to do that, the other part of it is that he has to go and save up enough money in order to pay the price to bring his bride home. It is a bride price that he has to pay to the bride's father. And so he goes and he works on the farm and he earns his own money. And I'm sure he does his own side hustles and all these sorts of things. And he adds on to the house so their house is big enough and there's a room for them. And they have a place that they, as a new couple, can call home. And so when Jesus is saying this to the disciples, I go and to prepare a place for you. And when my place is prepared, then I will come back and I will get you and I will take you home to be with me where I am. He is, in essence, getting down on one knee and saying, will you marry me? And I am sure the disciples were probably a little bit taken back by that. But the point that Jesus is trying to make through all this is not trying to marry them in a worldly kind of sense. What he's trying to say is really three things. Number one, that God desires an intimate and personal relationship with every single one of us. That God's desire is to have a personal and intimate relationship with every single one of us. He doesn't just want a relationship with you on Sunday morning between 11 and 12 a.m. or 12 p.m. And he doesn't just want a relationship to you when you're in crisis. And he doesn't just want a relationship with you when it feels good. God wants he wants you to be at home with him no matter where you are, no matter what time of day it is. He wants that kind of a relationship with you. He also went to go pay the price for us. He went, Jesus had not yet gone to the cross when he said these things to the disciples, but he knew the cross was where he was going. And he went and he paid the price for our sin. And our shame, he bore that all upon himself, upon the cross. He paid the price for we, the bride, that we could not pay for ourselves. And then thirdly, God wants us to live with him in his eternal home. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will then come back and I will get you. I will pay the price and then I will take you to be with me so that we might live together, not just on this earth, but eternally in heaven in a home not made with hands. The Bible also tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8, that to be absent in the body is to be present with the Lord. I get ahead of myself here for a second. I just get excited about this topic. Because you see, the question becomes, where is this home that Jesus goes to prepare? He wants it to be an intimate and personal relationship with us. He's paid the price for us. And now he wants us to come and to live this eternal home with us. But the question is, where is this home? Well, the Bible teaches us that when we die, a person of faith is absolutely safe. In the love of God and in the presence of Jesus and waiting with all the saints for the day of the resurrection. It also tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8, that to be absent in the body is to be present in the Lord. Now, I spoke about this reality at my father's funeral, and I said that my father was a seed that had been planted in God's good soil at his death, and that he now blooms in heaven, full and complete, and that all that remains on this earth is but the husk of the seed. As Scripture confirms, for this perishable body must put on imperishability, and this mortal body must put on immortality. Heaven, a heavenly home, is a very real place. And for this I am grateful. But as the old commercials used to say, do you remember the Ginsu knife commercial? For $19.95, you can get this Ginsu knife. But they'd always say in the commercial, say, oh, but wait, there's more. Heaven, in the image that we have, is grander than we know. This isn't just people sitting on clouds playing harps and wearing white robes all day. The Bible points to something more. There is a grander vision of heaven than many of us believe. What we learn from Scripture is immortality is a gift, but it is also, as N.T. Wright proclaims, an immortal physicality. That's a big $2 word right there, okay? It's an immortal physicality. In other words, it's not simply a disembodied soul floating around with wings and harps and all those things. There is something more going on that God has prepared for us. It is a new creation that begins with a bodily resurrection. And just like Jesus, we who are in Christ will experience a bodily resurrection. And at the resurrection, we will put on this new imperishable body that will no longer be affected by death, that will no longer be affected by disease, that will no longer be affected by mental or physical limitations. And what's more, this life beyond death ends up in a new and better home. Listen to what John says in the book of Revelation. He says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there were no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them and their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.' He who was seated on the throne said, 'I am making everything new.'" Revelation chapter 21 and 22 go on to elaborate what this new heaven and this new earth looks like, what this eternal home with God will be like, where believers will be with God and where they will be his people and God himself will be with them and be their God. Now, does any of that sound familiar? That phrase right there from Revelation 21:3? Well, if you're an Old Testament scholar, you'll recognize that phrase over or in some way, shape, or form. It's said over and over again in the Old Testament, in Exodus, in 1 Kings, in Numbers, in Leviticus, in Ezekiel, in Zechariah. For example, we read in Exodus 29, "I will dwell with the sons." This is God's desire, to dwell with the sons of Israel and will be their God. In Zechariah chapter 2, it says, "Many nations will join themselves to the Lord in that day and will become my people. Then I will dwell in your midst, and you will know that the Lord of hosts has sent me to you." This idea where God will dwell among his people, and they will be his people, and he will be their God, all begins not just in the Old Testament, but in the very beginning of the Old Testament. We read about this picture in the Garden of Eden, back before sin entered the picture. God was creating the world and placing humanity in that garden and did so that he might have a place with them, a home with humanity, where he might dwell with his people and where he might be their God. And it worked for a time. It worked for a time. And Adam and Eve would walk with God, it says, in the cool of the evening. They enjoyed a special, intimate relationship. But as I said, sin entered the picture. Yet God did not give up on his dream. He did not give up on his plan. In fact, he made a way so that his plan could come to pass. And that we know is through Jesus Christ and through his suffering and his death, his resurrection and his ascension. And because of what he has done, he has gone to prepare a place for you and for me where sin can no longer interfere. A place of a new creation, a new heaven, and a new earth. And in essence, what he did was create for us a restored Eden where God will be with his people and his people will be with God. N.T. Wright is known for saying, "Heaven is important, but it's not the end of the world." The end of the world involves God creating something new, a new home, a new world, a place where Jesus went to in advance in order to prepare for us, and as he said to his disciples before his crucifixion. As I began this message, we talked about how inside of us there is always this longing for home. It is because we have been designed to live with God in such intimacy. We have been created in such a way to be in relationship with the relational God that God is. God's desire from the beginning is always to be at home with you. And so God has placed deep inside of us this desire and this need to have and to live and to be in this place of home not made with human hands. For it is true. Our place of citizenship. You see, our citizenship is not on this earth, for our earth is not our true home. The United States is not our true home. Texas is not our true home. Bullard is not our true home. For as Paul writes in Philippians chapter 3, our citizenship is in heaven. The new heaven and the new earth which God has prepared for us. Would you pray with me? Gracious Lord, as we have gathered together on this day and we are reminded of what you have done for us in advance, that you have prepared for us a place where that we will one day go and be with you and live for eternity with you. We give you thanks, O Lord, first and foremost for the sacrifice that was necessary in order to make that happen and that Jesus was willing to do that. May we receive that fully in our lives, so that we may walk in eternity with you, O Lord our God. And Father, I pray for those that are here today that this time on this earth has weighed heavy on them, because on this earth we are bound by sin. We are caught up in the effects of sin and the limitations of a broken world and a broken body. And Father, there are many of us that may be struggling in this world today that long for that home so they might be with loved ones, so they might be at a place of peace, so they might be at a place where they are not betrayed by their own body anymore. And I pray, Father, that for those that they would wait patiently for the time when the time is right and you do call us home to that place, eternity with you. And until the meantime, Father, may we rely upon your strength, rely upon your grace, draw heavily upon your presence with us, that we walk each day with you on this earth until we are received in our heavenly home. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Our closing song this morning is Spirit of the Living God. If you are here this morning, God is moving your heart and life, and you're ready to publicly profess your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Or if you have already done that and you are ready to become a member of Bullard First United Methodist Church, we would love to talk to you about either one of those things. Come see me after the service today. I want to answer any questions you may have as well at the same time to be able to share with you about what it means to be a Christian or what it means to be a member of this church. And to maybe to set up a time to do that so that we can pray together and talk together and share together. This time I invite you to stand and sing Spirit of the Living God. My great joy and pleasure to introduce to you Charla Rosenthal, Did I say it correctly? Rosenthal. Rosenthal. Roundsenthal. Hey, there we go. Roundsenthal. I'm going to get it right. She is. She came to me this last week, and we sat and talked about what membership was all about, the vision and vision of this church, and ways that she can get plugged into that mission and ministry, and to join all of us in that. And so today she comes to transfer her membership and to become a member of Bullard First United Methodist Church. And so, Charlotte, I ask you before God and all these people, will you be loyal to this United Methodist Church, and will you uphold it with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? With that, I extend you the right hand of Christian fellowship and brotherly love and welcome you as the newest member of Bullard First United Methodist Church. Let's welcome her. Charlotte, this time I'm going to invite you to go ahead and make your way out back there and just stand by the back, and everybody will want to come through and greet you here in just a minute. Would you receive now this benediction? Go forth as the children of God, who lead lives that point others to Jesus. Do so not in your own strength and power, but in God's strength and power that leads us all one day home. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all gathered together said, Amen.